Hello everyone. There is something very original about listening to a story being narrated in a compartment of a moving train. In this lesson, The Storyteller, Part 1, let us see how this story unfolds. The Storyteller. Now, before I start with the story, you may take your textbooks just to follow where I am reading from and maybe to write down the meanings of certain words if you need to. Let us begin. The Storyteller. It was a hot afternoon and the railway carriage was correspondingly sultry, and the next stop was at Templecombe, nearly an hour ahead. The occupants of the carriage were a small girl and a smaller girl and a small boy. Their aunt occupied one corner seat, and the further corner seat on the opposite side was occupied by a bachelor who was a stranger to their party, but the small girls and the small boy emphatically occupied the compartment. Both the aunt and the children were conversational in a limited, persistent way, reminding one of the attentions of a housefly that refuses to be discouraged. Most of the aunt's remarks seemed to begin with "don't," and nearly all of the children's remarks began with "why," and the bachelor said nothing out loud. "Don't, Cyril, don't," exclaimed the aunt as the small boy began smacking at the cushions of the seat, producing a cloud of dust at each blow. "Come and look out of the window," she added. So it was a hot, sultry, hot and humid afternoon, and the railway carriage was in the same correspondingly hot. Next stop, Templecombe, an hour ahead. And the people who were in the train were a small girl, smaller than that, another girl and a small boy accompanied by their aunt. And on the opposite side was a bachelor, unmarried man. He was not part of their group or party, but these children, they were very noticeable in a compartment. Imagine that you are going somewhere and 1 hour more there is a ride and they have nothing to do. So they were so bored there, and then therefore they were there persistently continuing to do things, you know, reminding one of a housefly. You know, when a housefly comes into the house, however much you try to throw that housefly out, it will keep on coming there and making you aware that I am here. So the children were like that. And all the time the aunt kept saying, "Don't do this and don't do that." And the children asked her, "Why? Why can't we do this?" You know, and the bachelor was obviously listening to everything, but he said nothing. Now, the last thing that the aunt said was, "Don't, Cyril, don't do that," because he kept smacking or striking a cushion in the train. And every time he smacked it, there was dust coming out of it. So she says, you know, "Don't do that. Come and look out of the window." The child moved reluctantly to the window. "Why are those sheep being driven out of that field?" he asked. "I expect that they are being driven off to another field where there is more grass," said the aunt weakly. "But there is a lot of grass in that field," protested the boy. "There is nothing else but grass there. Aunt, there is a lot of grass in that field." "Perhaps the grass in the other field is better," suggested the aunt fatuously. "Why is it better?" came the swift, inevitable question. "Oh, look at those cows," exclaimed the aunt. Nearly every field along the line had contained cows or bullocks, but she spoke as though she were drawing attention to a rarity. Now, when she called Cyril to the window, he moved very hesitantly or reluctantly. And as he looks there, he asks a question. "Why are those sheep being driven out or taken out of that field?" The aunt doesn't know what to say. So very weak, lame answer. She says, I think they are being driven off because there is more grass in the other field. Now, Cyril is very observant. He says, but there's lots of grass in the field. Okay? There's nothing else but grass. There aren't. Why are they being taken out? Because there's a lot of grass there. The aunt doesn't know what to answer now to this child. And so very fatuously, silly, pointless manner, she says, maybe the grass in the other field is better. Huh? This child is not going to leave that answer. He says, why is it better? Grass is grass. Okay. And the question was inevitable, unavoidable. If she gives such a weak, silly, pointless answer, obviously he's going to ask another question. So now she doesn't know what to say. She says she tries to change the attention of the child from the sheep and says, oh, look at those cows. Okay. Now she's looking at those cows and telling him to look at those cows as if to say they were a rarity, something that is not common. And all the time they were passing, there were so many cows and bullocks. But the child's attention was not diverted. Why is the grass in the other field better? Persisted Cyril. The children don't get a proper answer. They will keep asking till they get proper answers. Now the frown on the bachelor's face was deepening into a scowl, a very angry expression. He was a hard, unsympathetic man, the aunt decided in her mind. She was utterly unable to come to any satisfactory decision about the grass in the other field. Now, while Cyril has been tackling his aunt about why is the grass in the other field better, and she was unable to come to any decision, she was looking at the bachelor's face with an angry expression. And she decided that this man is not good. He is a very hard man. He is not sympathetic towards the problems that young children are giving. Okay. Moreover, the smaller girl created a diversion by beginning to recite On the Road to Mandalay. She only knew the first line, but she put her limited knowledge to the fullest possible use. She repeated the line over and over again in a dreamy but resolute, very determined and very audible voice. It seemed to the bachelor as though someone had a bet with her that she could not repeat the line aloud 2,000 times without stopping. Whoever it was who had made the wager was likely to lose his bet. Come over here and listen to a story, said the aunt, when the bachelor had looked twice at her. The children moved listlessly towards the aunt's end of the carriage. Very evidently or clearly, her reputation as a storyteller did not rank high in their estimation. So now, as Cyril is troubling her, asking about the grass, the smallest girl, she changes, creates a diversion, and she starts reciting On the Road to Mandalay, a poem, but she only knew the first line. And so, with that limited first line, she kept on repeating it again and again, moving from one place to another, coming near the window, in her own world, but determined and a very, clear voice. Okay. And the bachelor's thinking to himself, I'm sure somebody has had a bet with her, a wager with her, and that person was going to lose that bet. Because she was repeating and repeating, and that bet may have been that can you say On the Road to Mandalay 2,000 times? This girl was repeating it so many times. So the aunt is looking at the bachelor, knowing that he is going to be angry. So she tells the children, come over here, listen to this story. Okay. Now the children moved listlessly. They were not interested. They were not enthusiastic. Because clearly, she was not a good storyteller. In a low, confidential voice, interrupted at frequent intervals by loud, petulant questionings from her listeners, she began an unenterprising and deplorably uninteresting story about a little girl who was good and made friends with everyone on account of her goodness, and was finally saved from a mad bull by a number of rescuers who admired her moral character. Now, very softly, because the aunt knows that the bachelor is getting fed up of these children. So she was started telling her story, and in between they were keeping on asking, you know, they were interrupting her by loud, petulant, very like, you know, sulky questioning from the listeners, because she began a very boring, deplorably means disgracefully uninteresting story, and very common story about a girl who was good. She made friends with everyone because she was good. And then when a mad bull ran behind her, there were many rescuers to save her because they admired that she was very good. Now see one of the questions. Wouldn't they have saved her if she hadn't been good, demanding the bigger of the small girls? Now this was exactly the question that the bachelor wanted to ask. If she was bad, would they have saved her or wouldn't they have saved her? Well, yes, admitted the aunt lamely. Now she cannot, you know, very weak answers she is giving to all the questions that are coming her way. But I don't think they would have run quite so fast to help her if they had not liked her so much. The answers which she is giving do not satisfy the children. She says, yeah, they may have run to help the person who was not so good, but maybe they would not run so fast. So the bigger of the small girls, she says, this is the stupidest story I have ever heard. Okay? And Cyril says, I didn't listen after the first bit because I knew it was going to be so stupid. The smaller girl actually made no comment on the story, but long ago she had recommenced or began again murmuring on the road to Mandalay. Suddenly the bachelor from his corner says to the aunt, you don't seem to be a success as a storyteller. The aunt bristled, got very angry, offended, in instant defense at this unexpected attack from the bachelor. And she replies very stiffly, you know, very, unfriendly manner, not relaxed. She replies to him, it is very difficult to tell stories that children can understand and appreciate or realize the worth of. I don't agree with you, said the bachelor. So the aunt replies to him immediately, perhaps you would like to tell them a story. Tell us a story, demanded the bigger of the small girls. Once upon a time, began the bachelor, there was a little girl called Bertha, who was extraordinarily good. The children's momentarily aroused interest began at once to flicker. All stories seemed dreadfully alike, no matter who told them. She did all that she was told. She was always truthful. She kept her clothes clean, ate milk puddings as though they were jam tarts, learned her lessons perfectly, and she was polite in her manners. Okay, so the bachelor begins like everybody else begins. Once upon a time, there was a girl, little girl called Bertha. Now see here, he is giving details, telling the name of the girl here, giving the girl a name, and she was extraordinarily good. Now, the children's momentarily aroused interest, they were stirred up because now they're going to listen to the story from a different person. But all that interest began to go down, vibrate downwards, because they thought that he is going to come with a similar story, all alike. Okay? So he continues with the story, saying that Bertha was truthful, kept her clothes clean, she did what she was told, she ate her milk pudding so carefully as though they were jam tarts, you know, learned her lessons well and polite in her manners. So this Bertha was a very, very good person. Was she pretty? Asked the bigger of the smaller girls. Not as pretty as any of you, said the bachelor, but she was horribly good. Okay, so now the girl asks a question. Was she pretty? So she gets an answer which satisfies them. not as pretty as any of you, so the children are feeling happy. But then he comes out with two words which make them very, very excited. She was horribly good. Now, horribly good here meaning very good. But you don't use the word horrible to say that she was very good. So now he is using two opposite words to say that the girl was very, very good. But those two words, you know, excited the children. Now, when we use two words like this, you know, when I mean very good, but I'm saying it exactly the opposite, then the figure of speech is called oxymoron. Okay. Now, the minute he said horribly good, there was a wave of reaction in favor of the story. Okay. The word horrible in connection with goodness was something new, a novelty that commended itself, felt very good. Okay, the bachelor is telling a good story just because he used those two words. It seemed to introduce a ring of truth, okay, that was absent from the aunt's tales of infant life. A ring of truth meaning it felt like there was some truth in the story that he was saying. And they felt it was praiseworthy and it was a new kind of approach towards telling a story. Okay, very quickly, let us go through some of the question and answers in your textbook. How many occupants did the compartment have? The compartment had 5 occupants: the aunt, a small girl, a smaller girl, Cyril, a boy, and the bachelor. Why did the aunt have to use the word don't so often? The children were distracted and continuously doing things that were irritating the bachelor. So the aunt had to keep saying don't. How did the smaller of the two girls irritate the bachelor? The smaller of the two girls started reciting On the Road to Mandalay. She kept repeating this line over and over again. To which question from Cyril was the aunt unable to give a reasonable answer? Why is the grass in the other field better? Was the question from Cyril, to which the aunt had no reasonable answer. Continuing with the question and answers, how did the children show their disapproval of their aunt's story? The bigger girl said it was the stupidest story she had ever heard. Cyril agreed and said that he had stopped listening after the first part. The smallest girl just began a murmured repetition of her favorite line, On the Road to Mandalay. Why do you think the children disapproved of their aunt's story? The aunt began narrating an extremely unenterprising, uninteresting story about a girl who was good. There was no character or punch to the story, and hence they disapproved. How did the bachelor describe Bertha? The bachelor said that Bertha was extraordinarily good, truthful, neat, clean, learned her lessons well, and was always polite. He described her as horribly good. An interesting story follows in the train, to be continued in part 2 of The Storyteller.